I didn't say anything. Yeah. Hello. Good evening and welcome to IAAC. I'm delighted and honored to have such a guest like Indy Johar with us tonight, an architect, co-founder of Project 00, which involves a lot of projects we love and you will hear about, like WikiHouse of Opendesk. You heard about that before, probably, some of you. So this gentleman is one of the masterminds behind that. And but also I'm also delighted because I think we are going to open a very, very interesting conversation around the future of cities in the context of distributed technologies. And I'm not going to go too deep on that, but I think that's where really the meat of the conversation tonight is, and how we can make that happen. So I'm not going to take any much more time from Indy's lecture. And again, thank you for joining us. And the stage is yours. Thanks.
Thank you. Just wondering whether I should sit or stand. I'm going to stand, actually. Hello, I'm really delighted to be here and really honored to be here. Thomas is an inspiration for having done so many amazing things and being part of creating a massive movement which we're seeing around the world. So and to be in his house is a real honor. So firstly, thank you. Secondly, I think in a way I want to put down a provocation today. I want to share some things that we're thinking about that are probably at the edge of our play. I'm not going to sit around talking about all our projects in the classic architectural sense of going showing you nice buildings for the next 20, 40 minutes and boring ourselves to death, things you can see anywhere in lots of other places. I am going to go through some of the kind of challenges that I think we face. And in a way, what I want to focus on is the dark matter of the nature of our cities, the boring stuff. How do we regulate? How do we do insurance? How do we do warranties? How do you do all the boring stuff that is actually at the center of how we make our cities? Because the thesis I want to put down today is that architecture is not necessarily controlled by the fancy photographs. Architecture is controlled by the boring stuff. And I think we're living at an age where the boring stuff is about to be radically reimagined. So OpenDesk WikiHouse, perhaps many of you know these projects, but what you very quickly discover at the end of distributed manufacturing of products is that actually the challenge is how do you do insurance? How do you do distributive insurance for a WikiHouse? How do you get a mortgage on a WikiHouse? How do you borrow money to actually do projects like this? And you start to realize that whilst we have the physical technologies to do distributed manufacturing, we don't have the institutional technologies to do distributed manufacturing. What I want to put down is that I think the real revolution is actually building the boring stuff again. The nature of our cities and the nature of the nation state we live in is actually very, very well echoed by a revolution in bureaucracy that was happened at the time of the Kaiser. The Kaiser reinvented bureaucracy and thereby gave birth to a nation state as we see it and the welfare system as we see it now. I think, and I think many of you probably know as well, that we're in the middle of a revolution of the nature of bureaucracy. That revolution is fundamentally going to change the nature of how we construct and make things and the nature of how we organize things. So there's a kind of lecture there, which I will talk about in a second, but I want to sort of expand that conversation a little bit because I think it's really important. If we go down that route, what becomes apparent is that here's a little trick. If, as a typical architect, I would stand here in front of you and I would say, I'm going to design you this really lovely office, right? And this lovely office is going to improve communication in your team. Yeah, that's what I'd say. I'd say it's going to reduce the number of people that are taking sick, are going to stay away from the office, it's going to reduce sick leave. It's going to make people happier. I'm going to say all this stuff, right? Most architects will sell it on the performative human impact. They will say how it's going to make people happier, less people are going to take sick leave, communication is going to be better, your staff are going to be more innovative. This is how actually increasingly architects would stand in front of you to talk about the nature of the buildings they build. Now, the interesting moment is that actually increasingly we can start to look for data points that drive those propositions, right? We can look at sick leave. We can look at the social network analysis of an office and how that office is being affected by how the team is being affected by the office that's being put in forward. So we increasingly have data points to be able to actually talk about this stuff and reflect that back into the impact of architecture. Not in the classic, you know, post-occupancy evaluation of taking a little study, walking in there and talking to a few people, but you can look at it real time continuously. Now imagine a proposition where I would say that as an architect, you aren't paid for the cost of the building, but you're paid for the performance of the outcome. So we as architects make lots of claims. The client turns around and says, that's cool, we buy it. We're going to now pay you on the basis of the performance of the outcome. Now this sounds stupid, right? You guys sit there and go, pfft. But the really interesting thing is this is starting to happen. So in the social investment world, in social impact bonds, how many of you know social impact bonds? Probably none of you. Social impact bonds are basically means where a state will turn around and say, if you can reduce the means of reoffending, people going back to prison, we will pay you money for the number of people that actually less that go back to prison. So a performance basis outcome. Your intervention can be whatever you choose, right? You can choose lots of different intervention points. It doesn't define the intervention, it just focuses on the outcome. So we're seeing new models of contract come into being because actually there's new data points and new means of organizing them. Imagine that same revolution in architecture. Suddenly you're not designing buildings, you're curating environments. Yeah, you don't just walk away, design the building, it's a nice funky building, I'm done, goodbye, thank you. To actually focus on the curatorial value of that product. How does it performatively improve that environment? Imagine that contract for architecture. Imagine what that would do to the nature of data. Imagine what it would do to the nature of performance evaluation. Imagine what it would do to the status of architects, not merely the kind of designers of the object which leave, but actually continuous value-added creators to the environment that we contribute to. Now, the reason why I bring that about is I think if you shifted the architectural contract, it would have a radical transformation on the nature of the architecture we build. And also it would have a radical transformation on the nature of you as architects. Architectural pay has largely been declining pretty much everywhere, right? It's largely because we are not able to construct a means of create articulation of value in many means. What I'm saying is I think there's a new means of organizing it, but we're often only interested in the images. We're never interested in the boring stuff. How do you reinvent the architectural contract for a new world? I think that's the sort of questions we should be asking ourselves, because I think the data points and the infrastructure exist to do that. A smart contract focused on architectural outcomes. This is a crazy little project that we're playing with and will launch in November this year. Now, at the same time, just to give you a bit of precursor, in 2011, when we dreamt up the idea that we should do a WikiHouse, people also looked at us in a slightly crazy way. And so I said, really? But I think we're at that moment where there's the next poems can be written. And so a lot of the things that's really becoming of interest to us is how do we start to think about the dark matter of the cities we organize within us? And I think that is a real revolution waiting to happen. And that happens in the nature of urban regulation, that happens in the nature of insurance and warranties. So for example, one of the big challenges we've seen is that if you want to buy a WikiHouse, if you want to have a WikiHouse made, well, the reality is every WikiHouse has a unique supply chain. So how do I do a warranty infrastructure with a unique supply chain because it's distributed? Well, actually, increasingly using blockchain technologies, you can assemble a particular unique warranty infrastructure. So what if you were to able to create a new type of warranty infrastructure on a blockchain contribution? You can start to structure the means. And why is that important? Because if I can structure the warranties, I can actually get a mortgage. I can borrow money against the house to get it built, get it constructed. I can do lots of really interesting things as a part of it. So, but if I can't do that, I actually can't drive that. So OpenDesk, for example, one of the really big things we learned, that how do you ensure an open, so if Google want to get by an OpenDesk, right? Somehow you've got to create an insurance structure around the performance of that desk. So if it falls on someone or knocks somebody down, how is liability structured? Typically what happens is you centralize liability. So one organization will sit there and say, we will take liability. We will then thereby start to control every end of the chain. But if you want distributed manufacturing and distributed innovation, you automatically destroy it as soon as you bring all that stuff together. So in order to OpenDesk to work in a distributed innovative model, innovative space, where the supply chain is emergent, you have to create the insurance and warranty structures. Now, many of you guys, I hope, know this, but it's increasingly becoming the challenge. So we can sell OpenDesks through a centralized model with a centralized underwriting relatively easily. The challenge is now, how do you do that with distributed manufacturing and distributed warranty structures? That changes the nature of how we consume and produce and contribute. So in a way, that's the kind of beginning of this conversation for me. Like, that's why I'm particularly interested in this. But let's leave that right to the end, but I wanted to give you a framework to where we are trying to see the city and what that starts to mean. A little slide of 00, you'll see many of them. First thing I want to start with is, so why are we interested in this? One of the things we're very fascinated by is the nature of democracy and democratic cities. Most of our work, whether it's the Compendium for the Civic Economy or OpenDesk or WikiHouse, all these things have come from a fundamental ideal of actually a new model of democracy, which is about the power to create society. How do we distribute and decentralize the power to create society using new technologies? And I think that, to me, has become a really centerpiece to a lot of the work we do. Now, historically, when we look at democracy, we often think about this, right? We often think about the vote. That particular vote, right? We often think about actually the vote. And the vote is a very small component of democracy. Very small component. Democracy, in a full stack sense, if you look at it properly, was about, firstly, it was about banks for the poor. So if you look at the history of actually the birth of democracy, you see banks for the poor, you see libraries, schools. After, at the end of that, nearly 100 years after that, do you see the vote emerge? Because democracy is about the distribution of capacity and agency, and the vote is merely the articulation of one part of that story. It's a cherry on the cake. And the revolution we sit in is that we have a capacity to reimagine that agency of how we make our cities in a way that we've never had that moment before. So fundamentally, democracy is being remade, but not in the liquid democracy or the direct democracy little apps that you see around you. Everyone kind of goes, let's vote a little quicker. Voting a little quicker is not the answer, it's perhaps even the problem. Actually, what's more fundamental is how do we build the depth of democracy required? And I think that's a real central challenge to the nature of many of the Western societies that we've been living in. And the renewal of democracy in terms of the power to create society is a real fundamental challenge. And in this story, I think architecture has a particular story, right? Which is that architecture has largely been, you know, a 1% narrative, a kind of effectively a product and a means for the 1%, for the few. And the challenge for us is that, you know, architecture has historically always been that. There was a little gap for about 30 to 40 years in the middle of the 60s, where effectively most of architecture was being produced, or maybe 40 years, which is being state produced. But actually, for a large sector of society, it's always been a 1% story. And I think the challenge is that that is a thing that, I mean, this was an RIBA award-winning building, right? It was a private house of a castle, the converted castle, very sustainable, very beautiful, but this won the RIBA prize. If this is what we're giving prizes to, I don't think we understand the nature of the problem. In London right now, you've got people living shift work. They are sleeping in shifts in rooms. 8-hour shifts, 12 people. This is the reality of the urban environment that we live in increasingly. Yet, we end up glorifying nice looking buildings. I've had this conversation with the RIBA president and sort of Ben. You know, if you look at the schools of architecture, all we end up seeing is beautiful buildings. Actually, what about the real structural challenges our urbanity is really putting down on us? How do we start to really fundamentally deal with it? And I think that is a real question for us. We're going to be relevant in the world that we're operating in. You've all seen this stuff, right? So I'm not going to spend time dwelling on it. And in a sense, the kind of democratic map-making story, well, we know. Whoops. Stuff like WikiHouse, you've all seen this stuff, so I'm not going to labor massively on this. All the stuff around open design, how do you do this? I'm just going to flick through the stuff because I think, in a way, I'm not talking to you know, all this, all of these sort of things, they're all being done. And this is all being made, but this is nearly 4 years old, right? So this is where we're really able to do a lot of really interesting things. I think this is open source Windows, all the way through to technology, smart controls. And there are lots of these things being built literally all over the world and being varied and controlled and iterated in lots of different formats, and actually really effectively. But the real fundamental question here is, again, I think it's worth just us being honest with each other, so I'm going to take the time. Do you have a housing crisis in Barcelona? Right? You do, right? So, housing crisis, and typically what happens in a housing crisis is you'll see lots of architectural competitions to design new houses and to deal with the housing crisis. How do we build more houses? Here's a little theory about looking at house prices. A house physically is a depreciating asset. The physical house itself actually costs more and more to maintain over a period of time, right? That's technically, it's like a car, it depreciates, the physical house. Just talk about the physical house. The land itself, the physical land itself, is largely nominal value, agricultural value. You can find land of that particular size anywhere. What is really appreciating, and everyone sees these on these programs, I'm sure you have them, location, 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 right? Everyone says it's the location of that house that is appreciating in value. What does that really mean? What it really means is that common goods are appreciating in value. Labor markets, access to schools, access to public goods. The house is not appreciating in value. All that's appreciating is the constraint in public goods. So we've lived across a myth between ourselves that my house has gone up in value. Your house has not gone up in value. Public goods have gone up in value and you've artificially captured their value. So the house price crisis is not a house price crisis. It's a common goods crisis to which is disproportionately held by few. So often we see architects trying to resolve the wrong problem of designing the house when the challenge isn't the house, it's the legal institutional infrastructure of how we create value. And the reason why I say that is that, frankly, in this conversation, unless we are a bit very particular about understanding the nature of the problem, you can too easily fall prey to the classic story. There's a homelessness crisis, guys. Let's all print a small house and roll it in wheels in the middle of the street. That isn't the problem. In fact, homelessness across Europe costs £38,000 a year in emergency access costs. That's what it costs for someone to be homeless to the state. You can literally give them a free house. It's cheaper. So I'm just asking us to become very aware of what we design and how we design. I think as urban designers and urban placemakers, we're increasingly going to have to look at the nature of the systems and environments we create and the solutions we create in the non-obvious sense. Our solutions may not always be physical objects. They might be interventions of an order that are different. And I want to put this on the table because too often we kind of get asked, you know, hey, you got a wiki house, you can solve the whole housing crisis. No, you can't. The means of production is one thing, but there's other things going on to driving this. And we have to become very acute about understanding what we're saying and how we're saying it. Again, OpenDesk, similar sort of story. You've all heard it, and I'm not going to labor too much about it. Many of you know OpenDesk, right? Do you know it? How many people don't know it? One, two, three. How many people know it? Positive. Okay, so the really interesting thing for me, and I'll tell you the story, I'm sure you've heard the story, right, from Johnny and Nick, but one of the things I think I found fascinating about it was that, you know, how it started was that actually we ended up, by Mint Design, asked us to design one table. And we ended up designing it. We thought we'd 3D print it. We'd put it up. They ended up phoning us up and saying, hey, we've got an office in New York. Could you ship that table? Could you print one and ship it over to New York? I said, no, dude, we're not doing that. So we ended up sending the design files to some 3D printers we found on the internet, and we got them to print it and put it out there. Then we suddenly realized, well, hold it, that's interesting. And we put the designs up. And the designs up on a nice site. And within four weeks, we had 8,000 downloads, and it got into Hacker News. Our Hacker News put it like number two on Hacker News, and it suddenly just went viral. But what was really interesting, it was just that simple kind of unlocking, and it just got printed everywhere. Like Ghana, Sri Lanka, literally everywhere in the world, people were printing it, taking pictures and saying, hey, we could improve this, or we can use in Brazil. People were changing the materials and varying it and sending it back to us. And that was really interesting, and it's been sort of ended up printing in lots of different places. This is a really interesting story, which again, I'm sure you know about. This is Knowles West, friends of ours, Melissa Mean, who turned around and effectively phoned us up and said, a local council wants to buy some furniture. Instead of buying furniture, we want them to give us the money. So we will print, make a factory and print their, our own furniture. And she ended up making a factory in Knowles West from the same amount of money. There were £200,000, which is going to be given to buy furniture, and they made the factory and printed the own furniture and gave it to the council, and that factory is running right now into producing lots of really interesting stuff, and she trained people up. What was really interesting was she took what was a capital spend and turned it into revenue and built the whole organization out of it. And we've seen that happen in lots of different environments around the world, and it can be done lots of different ways. So in a way, that whole conversation you guys are really familiar with, I'm not going to go into massive amounts of detail, but that's stuff like about, okay, we know that open manufacturing and distributed manufacturing is creating possibilities. Now, let's also be honest with each other. The supply chains are very simple. The materials are very simple, right? We're not getting into complex materials. We're not doing complex additive materials. We're not dealing with massive complexity yet. And lots of those reasons are to do with actually the insurance and aggregative infrastructures and all that stuff that's on behind the table. So we are still far away from dealing with the level of complexity that we need to be able to deal with. Currently, we're doing simple product replacement, right? That's all it is. We're replacing products that largely exist in the universe, and we're rebuilding them in a new supply chain with efficiencies, right? So OpenDesk, pretty much you can print anywhere in the world and it'll get delivered 7 days, personalized and delivered within 7 days to anywhere in the world pretty much now, because we've built such a large network of actually 3D manufacturers and printers. And it'll largely be printed and delivered within 7 miles of pretty much any capital in the world. So we've reduced global supply chains, done all that. But the reality is we're still doing product replacement. We haven't changed the nature of the product itself, right? And I think that is something that we've got to hold on to, because I think we haven't yet understood, we haven't made that quantum leap of actually how distributed manufacturing fundamentally changes the nature of what we produce and how we produce it. We haven't built a whole new sector. And I think that's something on the table. Second part of the conversation I want to talk about. So if we say, okay, democratized making on the table. Second part on the conversation, which I think is really important, is architecture as a verb. Now, I love this equation. This equation was kind of part of the reason why I ended up quitting regular architecture and setting up 00. Because what it did was, and this is about hospitals, and this equation basically tells you the relationship between design costs, which is 0.1, capital cost, which is 1, 10% of design costs, which is all design fees, including engineers and everything. 1.5 is the maintenance cost of a building over 20 years. And 8, right, is effectively the human sort of employment costs over 20 years. What you start to see there is a gearage of 1 to 80 between design and the human performative outcome. 1 to 80 is the gearage. Architects are paid and structure value between the 1 and 10, right? The 0.1 and the 1, capital cost. Yet the real value of a building is on the 8 side. Right now, we have a real estate model which is, you know, you've seen the kind of fad of co-working spaces and you've seen the fad of kind of open plan desks and everything else. I would want to ask you is, do we genuinely think open plan environments are adding to the 8 or are they just adding to the 1? And I think that's the question we have to start to ask ourselves is, where is the leverage of architecture in the built environment? Is it about optimizing capital cost, or is it actually optimizing human performative value? And then finally, what's the local economic multiplier? So how is that building increasing local value, local flows, local contribution? How, where is it getting its food from? Where is it getting water from? Where is it all of this stuff? How is it a structural growth? How does it drive structural growth and locally multiply that economy? Imagine designing architecture down that chain. I did it to about 1.5, right? So I was designing a hospital building, and in the hospital building, there was air conditioning. And we were able to justify replacing the air conditioning with acoustically attenuated, very expensive windows with natural ventilation on the basis that the maintenance of the air conditioning would be more expensive than spending on various expenses. So you could offset future FM costs against actually design capital spend. Now imagine when you could do that against the 8. Now imagine when you could do that against the local multiplier. That these are the constraints that are actually controlling architecture and the nature of the environments we design. These constraints, these flows, these structures, most of our contracts are built on the 1 to 10 ratio, as opposed to the 1 to 80 ratio. 1 to 80 ratio, your work is like magic. Your gearage is amazing. You change 80, you have a big influence. So suddenly you start to realize, well, actually, there's a whole new idea of the nature of how we create environments in place. And I think this equation is at the center of how we're going to reinvent architecture for me. You have to engage with this equation for me. And we do nice buildings and fine. Like, I'm going to just flick through stuff, but The third part of the story is the other part that's been kind of really important to me, is a shift that we're seeing, which is a structural shift in the nature of how we see the world and structure stuff. Everyone's seen this diagram, kind of Vitruvian Man. It's kind of like, yeah, cool, everyone knows it. I think this is the end of this era. That diagram is at the end of its time. The reason why is I think one of the biggest challenges we face is for the last 300 years, we've been living in a world of what I would call Newtonian enlightenment, where we've seen the world in isolation. We've been able to see things in isolation, chemistry from physics, atoms from other atoms. We've seen things through isolating them and creating in vitro. That paradigm has been incredibly powerful over the last in driving a model of civilization. We see by separating things out, we've created a model of civilization. Now, I would profess over the last 20 years, our real challenges are increasingly not about our ability to isolate, but actually recognition of our problems of interdependency. Climate change, financial crisis, these are about problems of interdependency and our inability to deal with interdependency. And I think the challenge is that we've moved from a world where we can see things in vitro to a world which is massively interdependent. Now, if you were to take, and this is a piece of ethnographic work that was done, which is really interesting, that if you took a child from a Western background and you showed them a painting, the child would describe the object, and when you asked them to describe any further, they would slowly start to describe the context. If you took the same painting and you took it to a child from an Eastern context, they would describe the context, and when you pushed them, they would describe the object. It's fundamental in terms of how we see the world. Our object orientation has fundamentally created a way of seeing and structuring, which I think has become at the end of its time. Now, that challenge is really easy for me to say, right? But let me articulate it a little bit. Your mind, where is your mind? Mind's here? Well, no, not really. So how about this? Thomas, you have 68 million neuron cells around your heart. 68 million neuron cells around your heart. Actually, your gut has many, many more. Your mind is actually not just yours. Actually, what you find, your mind, not your brain, is actually a relational product. You weren't born with this knowledge. You weren't born with this expression. It's a relational product. Your physical body, Leonardo da Vinci drew it so perfectly, but the reality is, well, your physical body is a multitude. There are a large percentage of your physical body is not your even a human DNA. It's actually a massive symbiotic organisms that are living inside us that help us be happy, help us be okay. And actually, if they go out of balance, we can feel depressed, we can feel many other things. In epigenetics terms, your physical body is triggered by space and the context that you live in. And also in two generations into your past. We know that in epigenetics, poverty two generations before passes through your genes, and its impact is felt by kids two generations afterwards. This is as a result of looking at the Dutch famine. So when we look at your body and the idea of you, you start to realize, well, you're a relational you. You cannot be isolated and understood through isolation, but you're actually a product of massive, complex interrelationships in space, time, and thoughts and patterns. Yet, all of our thinking is increasingly being built on the idea of the sovereignty of the individual and the perfection of you. And that is driven through all of our thinking. We're doing a piece of work with the YMCA in London, where we've been looking at the notion of well-being. if you go to the end point of the conversation, well-being has increasingly become the idea of you being well. But we increasingly know that well-being is not about an individual story. Well-being is actually a societal or a familial story. It's not just about you in isolation, it's a product of the context and people you live in. So how do you design for a world which has increasingly become narrow to the nature of the consumer, right? So YMCA, all this sort of stuff has been narrow to the nature of the consumer. You build a gym which has got a little cycle that you do by yourself. But actually, well-being isn't structured that way. So how do we start to imagine creation in that world? I think it's a fundamental challenge. In a relational idea of self, in a post-consumer, the idea of the individual is not the final product, how do we create? The second part of the story that I want to put forward is this diagram. This is a diagram, a piece of work that was done around obesity. That is all the drivers of obesity. There are many, as you will see. There is no single driver. There's no single cause and effect. And increasingly what we're realizing is that actually many of the social challenges we exist in have a multitude of drivers behind them. There is no single magic bullet. There's no single intervention. How do you do change when there's 50 to 60 or 70 different drivers of obesity? Typically, as architectural students, we'll walk in and say, okay, we're going to make cities healthy by doing X. We'll make them more walkable. That's one contribution, no doubt. How do you deal with actually complexity in that sense? I think is increasingly a potent question. Because we've been living in the age of cause and effect, simplistic understandings of largely a complex world. Because we choose not to engage in that stuff. How often have we read briefs that around this stuff, a well-being city, and we come up with simple solutions? How do we start to deal with this? And I think what we're starting to realize is, firstly, that this complexity exists, and this complexity is nonlinear. So if I go to the next slide, this is a piece of work that was done by Joe Heshey, which looked at decline of fish stock. And what he ended up realizing was that gang violence was destroying trust, which was actually increasing overfishing in a community, in a village in North America. Gang violence, erosion of trust, increasing overfishing. So what you start to realize is complex nonlinear factors are driving outcomes. How do you design interventions into that world? So if you want to solve overfishing, do you deal with gang violence? Would you even come to that conclusion? I think that's the nature of the world we're living in, and I think that's the nature of the complexity we're dealing with. This is another diagram which Alistair drew, which I think is really interesting because it's, again, looking at the housing crisis, and you realize very quickly it's a complex product of multiple interventions. How do you design change into that knot? That is really our design challenge. The design challenge is not being able to make a nice product, but actually to be able to deal with that complexity of that knot. Here's another piece of work that we've been doing, which is looking at how people move into Dubai. If you want to go and live in Dubai, these are the number of interaction points that you have to actually just do that. Just touching all of that. And we've been asked to, we're working with Davzo, which is a really interesting agency, who's saying we want to reduce your time it takes to move to Dubai if you want to work there from 4 months to 4 weeks, right? And you end up looking at this whole stack of organizations and systems. How do you optimize change across all of these in a different way? That, I think, is increasingly becoming one of our biggest design challenges. How do we operate across systems? And in a way, I think this is one of the kind of interesting stories that we deal with, is that, I mean, this is a car crash in India, and actually many of you know India has one of the largest number of road deaths per linear mile than anywhere else in the world. And a friend of mine ended up moving out to India, looking at to trying to deal with it. And what he ended up, you know, he did lots of really interesting things, but he recognized some really interesting models. He went out there, he said, well, why aren't people helping people who get into a car crash? As many of you will know, you don't help people because you're afraid of the police. You get caught by the police, you can get into quite a lot of trouble. So most people stayed away. His friend passed away in the road because nobody chose to help him. He ended up actually driving a whole judicial ruling and various other things. He ended up then recognizing, well, who was saving men and women's lives? Well, actually, it was a police men and women. So he set up a reward scheme recognizing police men and women saving people's lives. But when people went to hospital, actually, doctors would not treat them unless they knew they had insurance, because doctors are paid through. So at that moment in time, he ended up lobbying the state government and drove the state to effectively drive to put mandatory insurance on the toll roads. So now there's emergency toll roads on that state. So any toll road that you go through in that state has automatic emergency healthcare insurance. Off the back of that, ambulances turned up. Off the back of that, the app was designed that you could call an ambulance. And the reason why I like telling that story is that was the problem, and the interventions were 5 or 6-fold to be able to design and mitigate that problem. Yet as designers, we often look for single magic bullets, when actually there's probably 5 or 6 interventions which simultaneously, in a coordinated fashion, can drive the level of change that we want. How do we work in that field? How do we work to solve problems in that reality? And I think that's a really important, and that's the nature of most of the complex problems that we're starting to deal with, is in that world. And I'm going to flick through some slides here, but and in a sense, I think there's a really lovely story that I have about, there's a town in the UK called Todmorden. And in this town, what happened was that two women decided to effectively plant carrots, cabbages, onions in all the public streets in the realm, right? They literally took over the streets and planted food. 7 years down the line, what ended up happening is depression rates were lower, unemployment was lower, empty shops had gone down, and I think the other thing was actually, yeah, the petty crime had gone down. Now, who here would have said that planting cabbages and carrots would have had those effects? If I'd asked any of you here, say as designers, hey, we need to increase employment rates and capacity, you would have all told me, let's have a startup fund, and maybe even a fab lab. Who would have said, actually, you need to plant cabbages? Nobody, right? Nobody would have. But the interesting question is, increasingly we can start to see with data, and we can start to prove these oblique design interventions. Because the oblique nature of those design interventions was all about building social capital, bridging social capital. That's what the carrots and cabbages were for. They built bridging social capital throughout that town, which had massive economic and other beneficiaries. Now, the real trick in the story is in 7 years, you can put a price to that. You can put a value to that intervention. You can put a value to the reduction in unemployment, the reduction in depression rates, the reduction in empty shops. You can start to put a monetary value onto that story. What does that mean for us? What does that mean for us in terms of how we design our cities and how we create them? And I think there's something interesting when actually we can start to value the oblique in a world where we become so causal, I think is really an important issue. Now, in a sense, I want to suggest something that what we've been learning over the course of all these three things is that democratic making, complex problems, which are multi-actor problems, and in a way, architecture is a performative product, right? These three things are coming together increasingly to change the nature of design and how we make environments. And in a sense, it's less and less about the product or the service. It's more and more about the system and the outcome. And it's less and less about glorifying the single intervention. But in complex problems, what you realize is that actually you need multiple intervention points. How do we start to design multiple intervention points is increasingly the challenge. How do you design systems, not objects? This is a piece of work that we did around redesigning a school as a distributed school. Because you realize there's enough capacity in a local town. Actually, with technology, you can unlock that capacity in a radically new way. So when you start to look at this stuff, how do you start to reimagine the functions and organizations that we're building? In terms of creating a master plan, we've been looking at a part of London, which is a medical city that's been proposed. And we said, well, actually, the issue is not a master plan, but how do you grow a movement? How do you drive citizen science? How do you use the supply chains of that hospital in terms of open laboratories for manufacturing medical instruments? How do you actually build the supply chains to create a whole movement of infrastructure as opposed to defining physical space? Now, when you start to look at this stuff, what's fascinating is clients are buying into this conversation. But what's fascinating is we typically don't have the tools or the means of drawing this stuff and communicating this stuff. So when you start to design these sort of new instruments, how do you start to communicate that? What does design look like in that world? And I think that's a really interesting moment and a challenge for us. And in a way that we can get into some of the semantics of this stuff around. And I think this is a really fundamental one. Increasingly, people aren't buying activities. What they're buying is outcomes. And social impact bonds, I really think you guys should look at them. Social impact bonds are this poem of a future around new models of financing. So let me give you a little story, because stories help illustrate this. So if you're a child, I happened to be in the US, and a governor of a prison turned around and said to me that if you give me the reading ages of children at the age of 7, I can tell you with 70% certainty which child will come to my prison. 70% certainty, reading ages at the age of 7. A child going to prison an adult going to prison costs $144,000 in the US a year. $144,000. It's probably more expensive than any university any of us have been to. Now, what's interesting is increasingly what you can start to do is actually finance preventative investment against that future. There's a brilliant piece of work that was done in Chicago, million-dollar blocks, that looked at urban blocks and said, this is the reoffending cost of those of people living in those urban blocks. How do you do preventative investment to mitigate those future costs? Now, those contracts and those means can be structured. And once those means can be structured, you can start to do urban renewal and investment in a way that we've never imagined it before. All of urban regeneration is largely currently based on financing or increasing the land value, not reducing social costs. How do you finance and invest in new ways is fundamentally going to change the nature of the city we build. Now, these things are increasingly possible. And what that means is it changes the nature of design.
How we do?
Yeah. Now, in a sense, I think we have lots of really interesting questions. I'm going to just get back one. And I could carry on for a long time, but the real message I want to put down on the table is that how we think about design and the infrastructure of design is changing. I think we have an opportunity to reframe design quite fundamentally. I think the nature of contracts, the nature of insurance, the nature of how we structure this stuff, the nature of how we think about problems and intervention is fundamentally changing. The challenge for us as designers are we going to change with them, or are we going to become merely cosmetic agents? Are we going to become the superficial cosmetic agents of change, or are we actually going to become the real agents of change into that future? That reality is coming. I guarantee you a building will be done in the next 3 to 5 years, which will be based around architectural performative outcomes. I guarantee you this. I'm not even joking. I guarantee you. We are already talking to suppliers and major developers who'd love this idea. This thing will happen. Now the question is, will we as architects be on the table? Will we as designers be on that table? Or will we just walk away just comfortable in being able to draw the nice graphic designs and say, hey, it's a cute picture that we've got? If we want to make changes to our city, I think we're living at a radical moment. But who makes the rules changes the nature of the city. The rules are open to be changed right now. So imagine a world right now where we were no longer regulating or classifying space, saying this is educational space, this is housing, this is offices. Imagine a world where that regulation wasn't being done by planners from the top down, but it was actually, all it was we required every space to have light, heat, sound, water, waste, pollution sensors, and you would look at actually the nature of pollution that each space was producing, not controlling what function was within it. Because when we historically did classification of our cities, it was largely to mitigate pollution and conflict between uses. It was a crude means of mitigating conflict and tension between uses. With digital technologies, we can start to actually optimize that crudeness. We don't have to make hybrid cities by saying we've got a shop on the ground floor because we imagine a shop in our mind, or we need a library here. Actually, we can start to create cities in quite a different way. Now, I'm not saying that's right or wrong. But what I'm saying is that world is now viable. If you want to change the nature of cities, you're going to have to change the nature of those rules that are going to be recast. And they're going to be recast soon. Increasingly, if you look at the big providers, what are they? So big furniture providers, they're very quickly figuring out their value is not the design, because people can copy their designs. Their value is the provenance of their design. Their value is the warranty and the insurance of their design. Increasingly, what I would project is that in the future, most of the distributed manufacturing products that we'll create, we won't be selling the products, we'll be selling the rights to the insurance and the warranty infrastructures, because that's the tradable value. The material cost is purely a commodity. These things are going to change the nature of how we create our environments and the nature of our cities. They can be chosen to actually radically centralize our future, because if you centralize your insurance capacity and your warranty capacity, you centralize innovation, you centralize risk, you centralize command and control, because if I'm underwriting all your designs, well, it's my quality assurance that you have to sign up to. It's my risk profile, my capacity to understand what your contribution is. So if you want to create a new radical democratic city, we're going to have to build the institutional infrastructures for that city. I think as architects and designers, we need to be focused on building and rebuilding that boring stuff. You remember all those cool diagrams we used to have about free-flowing cities and fluid cities and all that sort of stuff you'd see? I don't know. I mean, you can pick any architect. I won't even name them. Actually, what's really interesting is we can start to create those sort of hybrid complex cities. because the technology is allowing us to create and organize that stuff in a new way. But unless we build the institutional infrastructure, we can't actually be in control of it. So how do you start to design this, I think, is your fundamental challenge. Otherwise, you'll leave it to the likes of McKinsey's and other partners who will create the city in their vision, as opposed to fundamentally creating a city in a new way. And in Barcelona, I think you have a unique opportunity because you've created a density of conversation around open manufacturing, open production. You have a unique city which is actually fascinated by this scale of conversation. You have the circular economy conversations going on. You have a city which is impassioned about actually the kind of people movement. Many, many fantastic free schools and other new models of schooling being explored here. How do you start to create the new dark matter of the city? How could Barcelona create a school for that dark matter of the city? I think is fundamental. Now, I think I could carry on talking about some of this stuff, but I probably want to end on that sort of conversation because I think it's only if we create that dark matter right will we create a power to create society, which will be radically democratized. If we get it wrong, it'll be centralized and command and control driven. And in a way, 3D manufacturing will just be basically outsourced commodities because you will lose the capacity to innovate. With that, I'm going to close on that. And then I hope we can have a little bit of a conversation. I'm probably going to apologize because I've not given you a typical architectural lecture and not giving you the typical story of actually I could have spent hours going through WikiHouses or open desks or some of our buildings we're designing. But perhaps what I've really shared with you is some of my personal thinking and more actually the direction of travel that we're on. And this is something we've been focusing on for the last 24 months. And we're really focusing, putting a lot of energy towards this. And I would say that increasingly we're doing work in Japan, Dubai, New Zealand, Sydney. We're seeing this conversation actually have very, very tangible impact. The people skeptical of it are largely architects. That should scare you. The people that are actually able to engage with this conversation, we've been sitting in all the rooms that you can imagine. From people from the Prime Minister's offices to the heads of architecture registration boards looking at what a future architectural contract could look like and why that would be really powerful for preserving citizen rights. So one of the partners in this future architectural contract is a registration board for architects. And I think that's really interesting for me. That the people often that find this stuff relatively boring are the designers and the makers. And I think it's going to fundamentally change the nature of the world we build and how we build it. And in a way, I apologize if I've disappointed you for not giving you the kind of classic architectural lecture and proof of all the greatness that we are. I'd much rather have shared with you what we're really thinking and what we're really worried about and how what we're really investing our time into. I'm not saying this is a perfect debate. I'm not saying we've got this narrowed. But over the next 24 months, these are the projects you're going to see us build and see us execute and experiment with. And I'd much rather share that with a kind of great school that you are and a great academy that you are. Rather than actually project you some fine images and go, aren't we great? That's really boring. So with that, I'll end. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Indy. I swear we didn't want any other lecture than this. You didn't disappoint us. This is really what we needed to hear from you. Thanks a lot. So we are running a bit late because we started late due to a flight delay. The lecture, we enjoyed a long lecture. So maybe we're going to take just a few questions. So the quickest of you lifting your hands. I already knew you. All right, Alex and Centur. Who do you want me to start? Centur.
Thanks for the inspiring presentation. It was not a disappointment, it was an enlightenment. I would correct the words, what you said. But I have just one question. When, as architects, when we start focusing on performance-based design, then there's a question of, in the future, the performance of a space changes, evolves, when there's a technological intervention or cultural or social or social interventions.
Yeah.
How do we predict that, and how does the design adapt to that?
So I don't think we end up predicting it. I think we end up becoming curators of space. So I think it fundamentally changes us from trying to say, we've imagined the perfect space and off you go, to being actually having, imagine having a service contract, which means that you are constantly optimizing and curating that environment. So your contract doesn't end at the age of you having done it, but actually you're constantly looking at the data and you're optimizing it. So you become an optimizer of space and an iterator of that space. And if a new use comes in, you again vary it, which fundamentally so means that you have a completely different business model, right? So we're not trying to do long projective work. It's the optimization work.
Hi. Hello. It's going to be a bit of a long question because I think it's a difficult notion, but bear with me because there's a point here. You made a reference to biology, and what I keep from it is the complexity of the systems. And when I'm thinking about biology, I'm thinking about a very interesting contradiction that I think can also be translated to societal systems. The contradiction is that biological systems basically are based on selfishness that leads to altruism. The gene's purpose is to replicate itself, and it doesn't think of anything else. And from this gene's selfish purpose, we have an altruistic being that is the human. And this is the contradiction that I've found during these 5 months studying here with Thomas. It's this contradiction of when you're trying to design a system, thinking of the bigger picture, you have to think of the single node. And usually the single node doesn't think of anything else but itself. And when you're trying to convince the node that, you know what, you're just a part of a greater system, it still doesn't care. But it's very crucial to not convince, but maybe lead the node to understand that there is an interest for itself, and maybe even forget about the existence of the system. And thus the system works. And my question is, how do you manage this selfishness?
Yeah, it's a great question. Yes, you can either try to imagine that every node in the network becomes superhuman and godlike and understands every interdependency, so it becomes so aware of all the costs and externalities that it generates that it's able to deal with that. Or what we're increasingly seeing is imagining it much more like neural networks. So you build a network layer which is above a meta layer. So you have the first end layer, then you build another layer over the top of it, whose role is to build actually the awareness of the nodes below it. So it isn't worried about, so increasingly what we're seeing is that in systems work, is that what you focus on is building the collective knowledge, collective agency, collective awareness of the system below it, rather than trying to actually tell it what to do. You're never giving executive power, you're just building awareness in the system. And so building shared language, so if you've got 40 different organizations driving obesity, you're not ever trying to tell them what to do. Because as soon as you do that, you end up with a command and control network. What you end up working on is actually building shared language, recognizing interdependency, why you do the system maps work. Then you say, second, you start to talk about actually the agency that they have, what interventions they're looking at. So you're always building awareness and interdependency rather than ever trying to say, you must do this or you must do that. So that's why we often talk about this work as movement work and talk about shared mission and accountability as opposed to centralization. So, but it's a really interesting question. It's one of the big things we're grappling with is that in multi-actor models of change, how do you organize and when do you actually disempower the sovereign nature of agency of the node, and where do you create agency and empowerment, and what the role of the meta layer is? And I think more and more we're seeing the role of the meta layer is a learning infrastructure. So it's learning and creating the learning capacity for the nodes at the end rather than the agency control. But yeah, it's something we're exploring. It's a good question.
Yeah, thank you. I had a question about, you gave a very positive image of Barcelona, but in fact there is a very acute problem now with rental prices and gentrification related to it. And since you talked about like organizing these gray areas, what do you see as solutions, public policy solutions that can really intervene and have set other priorities?
Well, I mean, there's lots of ways to look at this. So one is, so why I gave the example of a house, right? If we were to re-understand the house as being a depreciating asset, and actually what's appreciating is the common goods, i.e. the locational value in terms of schools, in terms of local amenities, actually you could fundamentally change the taxation infrastructure. Because suddenly your house, which increases in value, well, your house has not increased in value, public goods have increased in value. So your argument for taxation becomes fundamentally different. Because currently, if I turn around and said, we're going to tax the increase in value of your house, everyone would go, that's not fair, that's my house. Because that's the narrative we've been given. But if you were to reframe that narrative to say, well, actually, it's not your house that it's increased in value, it's common goods that have increased in value. And we're going to tax those increase in value, which you're capturing, to allow us to reinvest into a new location, build new social infrastructure, actually we can start to create a different discourse around house prices. Other things are, we have an illusion of housing being a market. I think we have to increasingly look at our housing and much of our real estate being a utility. I mean, the reality is, I don't know, most of architecture is a very, very low level commodity, right? So a building here per square foot to the building next door will have marginal difference in actual cost. Per square foot, it'll very low level of difference. Actually, most of your locational value is common goods. So how do we start to reframe this language as fundamental to allow us to build a new model for the nature of our cities? It allows us to create a new politics, if you want to be political. But actually, largely our problem is that we've lost control of this language. And we're not precise about the nature of where value is created and how value is created, and thereby how we create the nature of our cities. You know, we all think it's, you know, my house has gone up in value, but it's not your house.
Yeah. Okay, thank you for coming. Thank Indy for your amazing lecture. And so let's have some beer, but first help me thank Indy for your lecture.